My name is Tyler Treat, and I'm a recovering Go hater. Now I just have Stockholm syndrome, but no, I've written a lot about Go. I've spent quite a bit of time with the language now over the last several years. I don't consider myself a gopher, but I just think of myself as a programmer. But Go is probably what I use the most these days, and I'm guessing most of you came to this talk to learn about this one weird trick I'm going to show you to make your code faster. That's not what this talk is. And the better title for this talk really is So You Want to Subvert Go. And that's because we're going to look at some things that in many ways try to subvert the language. And the reality is Go really is not a systems language. I know that word is subjective depending on who you ask, but if you ask me, it's not a systems language. And that being said, it doesn't mean we can't build internet scale systems with it, right? And we've seen this with all of the new projects that have popped up. Many of them written in Go, and it's kind of become the lingua franca of infrastructure, if you will, for better or worse. And so, to get back to my alternative title, You Want to Subvert Go, the reason it's a better title is really this is a talk about how to write terrible, awful Go code. And it's really not a talk meant for a general audience of Go programmers, but more to talk about some things that I think are interesting, things that I've learned, and to also kind of tell a story of how the language has evolved over time. And so I have no doubt the Go team will wholeheartedly reject this talk. That's okay, that's their prerogative, but it's my talk, not theirs. And so I want to talk about writing performance-optimized Go from my perspective and my own experience. And also to talk about trade-offs, because when we optimize for performance, we're usually trading something off in return for that. So as I mentioned, my name is Tyler. I work at Apcera, where I work on the open source messaging system NATS. I have an interest in distributed systems. I have a blog, bravenewgeek.com, where I write about some of these things. And as I said, I work on NATS, which is an open source, high performance messaging system. I hesitate to call it a message queue because it's really not, but there are some similarities there. But it has sort of two guiding principles, which is simplicity and performance. And throughout this talk, we'll touch on some of the ideas and the principles that we applied while working on that and some of the things that we learned as well as they relate to performance. So why does this talk matter? Well, the compiler isn't magic. It doesn't just take in your shitty Go code and plop out this pristine machine code. It's very good at what it does. It does do a lot of optimizations, but it's not perfect, it can't read your mind. And so we have to be mindful of performance when it matters. And to be fair, it doesn't always matter, but when it does, we have to be thinking about that. And so the question is, what are we really talking about when we say performance? What does that mean? How do we quantify it? And if you saw the keynote this morning about optimizing tail latency, that's really, I think, what we're interested in, is like, how do we observe the behaviors of our system. And the problem is we're usually looking in the wrong places most of the time, and we're missing a lot of the problems that are happening. And so that's really what we're interested in, I think, is like, how do we optimize for tail latency? And that can be really hard to do, but when we reach a certain scale, it's often when things fall over. So in a previous job, I worked at a company called Workiva, which builds software as a service, kind of geared towards financial reporting. And one of the products that we built was a spreadsheets application. And early on, I was kind of involved with building out the communication layer for that. And one of the larger open source initiatives that came out of that work was a library called Go Data Structures, which, as you can guess, it's a library written in Go with a bunch of data structures. But with sort of an eye towards performance. And so we were looking at, like, how do we minimize garbage collection, minimize heap allocations, minimize lock contention, et cetera. And so Dustin Hyatt wrote majority of that as he was building the calculation engine for that spreadsheets product. But again, we'll talk about some of the things that we learned while working on that and some of the techniques that we applied as well. So we're going to touch briefly on measuring performance in Go. And then we'll just dive into the stuff, talk about a few language features, talk about memory management, and then wrap up and talk about concurrency and some multi-core techniques. So I can't emphasize this enough, but don't just blindly apply the optimizations that we're going to talk about. You know, as with anything, it depends, and there are trade-offs involved, and it depends when those trade-offs make sense and when they don't. And so I tend to think of optimization as kind of this two-step process where you like measure and then you optimize and you repeat that as needed until you've met your acceptance criteria. And you know, everybody says premature optimization is the root of all evil, and so it's good to have data. And Go actually ships with a lot of really nice tooling to help with that measure step, right? The profiling tools, how we can look at memory usage, CPU usage of our applications, the tracing, we can look at the garbage collector, how that interacts with our system, as well as the runtime scheduler, like how that schedules Go routines. And then kind of the other half to that is benchmarking. And as you know, Go ships with facilities for that as well to do kind of your code level micro benchmarks. And that's really nice to test for like performance regressions, but it's also easy to get caught up in trying to just shave every nanosecond off that you can. And so I think it's also important to kind of balance that out with more of the end-to-end holistic approach. And for that, I really like HDR histogram, which it's kind of a generic library, but basically allows you to capture from a very large range of values to capture very fine-grained measurements like latency, for example. And so I've built a number of tools around that to help with my own benchmarking and testing. And for example, that's how I generate like these latency distributions is with HDR histogram. So I've done a lot of benchmarking, and to start, I was really bad at it. And I think the only way really you get good at anything is to be really fucking bad at it for a long time. And by no means am I good at it now, but I think I certainly improved, at least in terms of my methodology and my understanding of these things. And benchmarking can be a really tricky business because often it is just that, right? And people have a tendency to just look at the data and ignore all of the context. And I think the problem is, and it sounds kind of counterintuitive, but you can't just ignore that context. And you have to be careful about how you interpret that data and be aware of like the benchmarking and things like that. And so it can be legitimately useful though for like quantifying performance and measuring that and looking for performance bottlenecks. So enough with that, let's dive into this stuff. And I wanna start by talking about a few language features that I think are sort of major selling points of Go, or at least kind of major features of Go, and when used in certain cases can lead to some surprising performance results, I think. So channels obviously are a big part of Go, as well as Go routines and its concurrency story. And in channels in particular, early on at least, were kind of pushed as like the way to do data synchronization of like shared state. And you know, this idea of share memory by communicating and to like pass ownership of data over channels as opposed to using you know, locks to mediate that access. And I think the problem with that is it misses out on a lot of the nuance of like when to use certain things and when not to. And I think since then there's been a bit more kind of pullback on that. But you know, when you look at the data, it's not really surprising that just using a mutex is quite a bit faster than like using a channel to do state synchronization. But even just ignoring the data, we understand locks, we've been using those for a long time. And so, you know, it's when you start to restructure your code in a way that allows you to use channels to do that, you typically end up with more complicated code in the end than you otherwise would have. So yeah, channels are great. They have their place. I think they're great for like coordinating Go routines and synchronize or orchestrating things. But for synchronization, you know, just use a mutex. And similarly, we can look at just the performance of channels for like work assignment or work throughput. And at the end of the day, the channel is just a ring buffer with a lock. And so, yeah, there's some tricks they do as far as the handoff semantics, and they'll like copy between Go routine stacks to optimize for that. But there's still a lock involved at the end of the day. And so you can typically go faster just with like the lock-free version of that. And to be fair, this isn't really that meaningful of a benchmark. I mean, you're probably not spending that much time inside a channel, but there was, Dmitry Vyukov had an implementation of lock-free channels. It never made it in, and I think the Go team was looking for further justification for the added complexity that brings. And I think that shows kind of that fundamental trade-off between like performance and complexity, and when does that trade-off make sense, and when does it not make sense? And in this case, they decided that it didn't. Defer was the target of a lot of criticism early on, I think, because of the performance overhead that it had. And this, I think this was kind of a known issue, or it became a pretty well-known issue. And the question now is it still slow? A lot of people deliberately avoid the use of it. And for the most part, no, it's really not. I mean, it's to start off with, yeah, there was a lot of overhead. But then in like Go 1.2 and 1.3, it really improved pretty dramatically. And it kind of crept back up a little bit. But today, it's kind of back at where it was in Go 1.3, which in this case, this is like with a mutex lock, unlock. It's like 40 nanoseconds of overhead. So I still avoid it in really tight loops. But outside of that context, it's not really anything to be thinking about. Interfaces are interesting in Go. And obviously, they're a major part of the language, and especially empty interfaces, which are used, I think, as a workaround to the lack of generics in Go. And they can lead to some surprising performance implications. So I think in the format package, there is an interface called Stringer. And let's take a type binary, which is a UINT64. We'll say we're on a 32-bit machine, so that takes up two words. And binary implements the Stringer interface. So the way interfaces work in Go is they're actually two pointers. There's a pointer to an iTable, which contains the type that implements the interface, and then a list of the functions, the function table, and those are the functions that on that type that implement the interface. And then the second pointer points to a copy of the data. And so that's used as like the first argument to each of those functions. And so there's some indirection that has to happen, right? When we call an interface method, we have to resolve that function, and then we have to resolve the data that's used in that function. And we can measure that overhead, and in this case, it's like 2 nanoseconds, so you're probably wondering, so what? But when we start to look at some more realistic-ish scenarios, the ramifications become a bit more clear. So let's look at an example. We have an interface, sortable iface. We have a struct, sortable, that implements that interface. And then we have these two slice types, sortable iface by number and sortable by number, which is a slice of, so this is a slice of the interface. This is a slice of the struct. And then these both implement the logic needed to sort them. So the len, the swap, the less. And then we sort 100 million of these things. And the results are kind of surprising, especially with earlier versions of Go. The difference is pretty staggering. But even with newer versions like 1.8, you know, it's about 25 seconds to sort 100 million structs and 100 seconds to sort 100 million interfaces. And it's sorting the same thing. It's just one is using the interface and one isn't. And so we can look at the profile for this. And it's kind of hard to read, but this is the interfaces that we're sorting. And we spend about 69 seconds inside of sort.sort. And we spend about 12 seconds inside of less and 37 seconds inside of number. And that's what we would expect, right? We're just sorting a bunch of things, so we would expect to spend most of our time inside like the insertion sort logic. And so we look at the profile for the struct version. We spend about 18 seconds inside of sort. And there's something missing here that was in the previous profile, which is that call to number. It's not happening here. And what's happening is inlining. And so the compiler is just taking that call and putting it directly into the call site. And it can't do that with the interface version because of that dynamic dispatch. So we can verify that with the -m compiler flag. the GC flags. And sure enough, there's two calls to sortable.number that are being inlined on line 84. And that's inside of less. So there's two calls to number. So the compiler is just taking those two calls and then moving them directly into that less function. So we can disable inlining with the dash L flag and kind of level the playing field a bit, so to speak, and look at the resulting profiles. On the left is the struct version. On the right is the interface version. They look kind of the same, basically, which is what we expect. They're both calling through to number now. And with the interface, or with the struct, we spend about 2.3 seconds inside of number. And with the interfaces, we're still spending over 42 seconds inside of number. So there's still a lot of overhead involved with that interface call. And we can look at the performance of method invocations and, again, plot that across different releases of Go. And obviously, just calling a method on a struct directly is the fastest. And it's basically constant. And then the interface adds a little bit of overhead, but it's also kind of constant. And then what's changed a lot is the performance of like type conversions. So going from like using a type assert or a type switch to convert from the interface to the concrete type and then calling a method on that. And in Go 1.5, that was when this conversion to the concrete type pointer was inlined directly into the runtime. And in 1.7, that was when the static single assignment backend and the remaining type conversions were inlined. So now just doing the type conversion using one of those two methods and then calling the method on that is basically on par with just calling a method directly on a struct, which I think is pretty impressive. And there's one more case I want to look at with interfaces, which is the empty interface. And as I mentioned, empty interfaces are commonly used as a workaround to lack of generics in Go. So we have these two benchmarks, benchmark arg iface, benchmark arg string, and functionally they're the same. The only difference is the interface version calls this function that takes an empty interface argument, and the string version takes a string argument. But you'll notice that these print booleans are always false, and so these print lines never actually happen in either case. But we run the benchmark, and the interface version is quite a bit slower, and we can look at the profiles and see what's going on. And on the left is the struct version. And there's not much going on, right? Which is what we expect. Benchmark arg string is just calling our arg string function. And that's pretty much it. And then on the right is the interface version. There's a whole bunch of stuff going on, and pretty much all of that stuff is garbage collection. It's all more or less related to garbage collection. And if you look closely, that's where the actual call to our guy face happens. So if we zoom in on this, what has to happen is the runtime has to convert our string to the empty interface. And to do that, it has to allocate that empty interface. And so it does that by calling this runtime conf t to e to convert from the concrete type to the empty interface type. That calls runtime new object. That calls runtime malloc GC, which does the actual allocation that obviously causes all of the garbage collection to happen. And so we can just kind of verify that and look at the assembly using the dash S compiler flag. And you know, sure enough, there's that call to runtime conf t to e that happens before our guy face gets called. And then on the right, that's the assembly, the Go assembly for the string version. And obviously, it's a lot more concise, but it's also missing that conversion call. And so this was an insight we gained while working on Go data structures, which is if performance really matters a lot, you're really better off writing or generating type-specific code. And so in our case, we were trying to write generic data structures or generic algorithms and using empty interface to do that. And we noticed that we paid a pretty big performance penalty in doing that. Let's talk about memory management for a bit. So byte to string conversion, something you have to be kind of careful with in Go, especially since Go, I think, tends to be well suited to building like networked servers, and so this tends to be a pretty common operation. So recently, there was a contribution made to NATS, which was like a small two-line change, and it ended up increasing the throughput of the server by like 2 million messages a second. And all it did was remove an unnecessary string allocation. If we look at the actual change set, so what this code is doing is it's reading some bytes off of a socket, converting that to a string, and then using that string to do a lookup in the map. And what this change does is it just inlines that string conversion directly into the map lookup. So functionally, it's like the same. The only difference is it's like getting rid of this intermediate variable. And yet somehow that increased throughput by 2 million messages a second. So the question is, what's going on here? And what happened was there was an optimization made for this specific case because it's such a common operation. And doing that lookup from like a byte slice and doing a lookup in a map with that key. And we can make the observation that when that conversion is in line in the lookup, it doesn't escape that lookup operation. And so rather than allocating that string, what they do instead is just allocate like a fake string header and then use the underlying bytes directly. And so in avoiding that string allocation, we reduce a lot of pressure on the garbage collector. That makes a really big difference, especially in the case of NAT, since that was on like a really critical path for the server. So I think that does a pretty good job of showing how what seems like a small change, an insignificant change, can have a really profound impact on performance if you're not, you know, looking for that specifically. And it also leads us into our next topic, which is memory allocation. And early on in Go, you could get some really big wins by being a bit careful about how you manage your memory and basically just trying to subvert the garbage collector and trying to like reuse memory and things like that, using things like slab allocation, arena allocation, et cetera. And I think in Go 1.4 maybe, sync.pool was introduced, which basically just retains a pool of objects that it, you know, reuses between garbage collections. And what's interesting is, at least in my experience, sync.pool tends to outperform a lot of these other low-level techniques, like the slab allocation, the arena allocation. These are doing some low-level kind of unsafe things, and they're like retaining large chunks of memory between garbage collections. In sync.pool, those objects still get garbage collected, and yet it still tends to outperform. And so it's kind of an interesting bit of trivia, but how is it that sync.pool is so fast? And the answer is they kind of cheat a little bit, and they use some runtime calls that aren't available outside of the runtime to do this kind of per CPU storage. And so the way sync.pool works is when you try to get an object from that pool, they pin the current Go routine to the processor. They disable preemption. And then each processor has its own local pool of objects that they pull from. And if that local pool is empty, they'll try to steal from another processor's pool before allocating it as a last resort. And in doing that, we avoid a lot of the contention issues that we otherwise run into. And so last I checked, there was an open issue for providing some kind of API that would allow you to kind of write your own data structures using a similar mechanism as sync.pool. And I think the Go team is trying to find the right balance between, you know, an API that's high level enough that it's not like easy to shoot yourself in the foot, but it's low level enough that it's actually useful. So again, one of those kind of trade-offs or balancing acts that you have to make. And I'd be remiss not to talk about concurrency, since obviously that's a big part of Go. So we'll wrap up by talking about that and some multi-core programming techniques. So I think the use of sync atomic overall is kind of discouraged in Go. And, you know, they say we generally don't want sync atomic to be used at all. Experience has shown us again and again that very, very few people are capable of writing correct code that uses atomic operations. Well, hold my beer. I mean, writing lock-free code is hard, right? Don't get me wrong. But really, it's just a matter of like replacing some mutexes with some compare and swap operations, right? Like, how hard can it really be? So this is a problem I explored a little bit within the problem of topic matching, which is a kind of a common problem in messaging middleware, which is we have a set of subscribers, we have a stream of messages, and we want to match those things up efficiently. There's a lot of ways we can do this, right? We can use like an inverted bitmap, which is a simple but pretty effective way of doing that. We could use a tree, which is a pretty good compromise between like performance and space efficiency. We could put a lock around that, make it concurrent. But I wanted to solve this in a way that would scale to a high level of concurrency and a large number of processors, right? Hardware is shipping with more and more CPUs these days, and Go positions itself as a highly concurrent language, and so I figured this would be a good fit for it. So I turned to the existing literature in sort of a similar space, which is concurrent trees, and it turns out we can take the same idea and kind of put a twist on it to solve this problem. And so the way this works is we just introduce these like indirection nodes into our tree. We do our compare and swaps on those inodes to avoid putting it into an inconsistent state. And it scales quite a bit better than the lock version. And this is just on like my quad core MacBook. So there's only four physical cores, but at least up to the four physical cores, it scales pretty well. After that, there's like hyper threading involved, but it's also quite a bit faster than the lock version. And one of the added benefits of this is we get constant time snapshots of our tree. So with the lock version, if we want to take a snapshot of that tree, we have to acquire the lock, copy the entire tree, and then release the lock. Whereas with this concurrent version, if we want to take a snapshot of that tree, we just copy the root node of the tree to a new generation, since it's a persistent data structure. And so the way this works is we assign a generation to each inode. We use the empty struct in Go to denote a generation. We could use an integer, but then we'd have to deal with like integer overflows, and so we can just push that problem off onto the heap instead. And then to make a change to this tree, we just add a new node. We copy the parent inode with the updated branch and then the new generation, and then we just do a compare and swap on that parent. But we have to do two things atomically here. We have to compare that parent inode to detect if the tree changed underneath us, so if somebody else came along and made a change. But we also have to compare the generation of the root of the tree to detect if a snapshot happened underneath us. And so we have to do these two things atomically in kind of this this generational compare and swap, which it's similar to like a double width compare and swap, which is doing a CAS into two contiguous addresses. But it's different in that we're actually doing a CAS in the two non-contiguous addresses, which isn't an operation supported on any modern architecture that I know of, at least. But it turns out we can solve this with just your run-of-the-mill compare and swap in kind of this two-phase commit fashion. And so we do that, but we still run into data races or race conditions. The Go race detector, it doesn't protect you from doing dumb stuff. So it guards against data races, but it doesn't guard against logical races. And so if you're using things like sync atomic and unsafe, all bets are off. And so what happened was this generational compare and swap was always succeeding, despite the fact that snapshots were happening on the tree, the generations of the nodes were changing, but our generational, this compare and swap was always succeeding. And what happened was I took an assumption from Java, which I had more experience with at the time, which is in Java, when you do new object equals new object, those things are always different from each other because they're different heap allocated things. They have different pointers, different addresses. But if you recall, we're using the empty struct. And in Go, the empty struct, or any zero size value, always occupies the same address. And literally, the last sentence of the Go language spec reads that two distinct zero-size variables may have the same address in memory. Well, I didn't read the Go language spec, or at least I didn't scroll all the way down to the bottom to see that. And so the fix, once we know that, it's pretty trivial, right? We just add this unused field to our struct, and our stuff just magically starts working. And so the side note here is unsafe, as the box suggests, is in fact unsafe. But also, if you read the Go 1 compatibility agreement, it states that packages that import unsafe may depend on internal properties of the Go implementation. We reserve the right to make changes to the implementation that may break such programs. So not only is unsafe unsafe, but if you're using it, there's no guarantee that your code will continue to work if you upgrade to a newer version of Go. And so it really is kind of the YOLO package of Go, and you have to be careful with it. And the key insight here is that struct layout can make a really big difference, not just in terms of performance, but in terms of just the functioning of your code. And it's also worth pointing out that the Go language spec doesn't make any reference to the words stack or heap. And so, yeah, we can get some big wins by being careful about when we stack allocate versus heap allocate. But as far as the language is concerned, there's no real guarantees around that. But it's this idea of mechanical sympathy, which is having an understanding of kind of the low-level mechanics of how things actually work can really help us. And kind of the classical example, I think, of mechanical sympathy is false sharing. And as Dustin was working on Go data structures, this is a ring buffer taken from Go data structures, he noticed that the performance of this ring buffer was quite a bit worse without these padding fields in between. And the way this works is we have this Q field and this DQ field, and they're being accessed concurrently by different Go routines. And so as one Go routine accesses the Q field, the processor pulls that into its cache, and that gets evicted from all of the other processor caches, and then vice versa. So as the other Go routine accesses the DQ field, you know, it does the same thing. And so they end up thrashing that cache line. And so by adding these unused fields, we basically push those into their own cache lines and avoid that contention. And that has a material effect on performance. And then similarly, you know, we can look at the scalability of like the channel from Go and how that compares to the lock-free version of that. And this is looking at from like one or two cores all up to 16 cores. And it scales quite a bit more poorly than the lock-free version. And the read-write mutex from the sync package also scales pretty poorly with CPU count. And this is kind of a known issue, I think. And the reason for that is readers all contend on this reader count field when they try to acquire a read lock. And so what happens is you have these readers, as they go about access or acquiring that read lock, you know, they pull that into their cache, that gets evicted from the other caches, and they kind of go back and forth playing this game of ping pong with that cache line. And so the way we fix that is, you know, we can fix it the same way we solve any horizontally scalable problem, which is we can partition. And we can assign a mutex to each processor. And that way, as these readers go about acquiring that read lock, they don't have that contention amongst themselves. And then as a writer, if I want to acquire a write lock, I have to go through each of these, acquire that before I can proceed. So for writers, this is really expensive. But the whole point of this is for really read-heavy workloads across a large number of cores. So the question is, how do we actually build something like this in Go? It's similar to sync.pool in that it has kind of that per CPU mechanism. But if you remember, sync.pool is using those internal runtime calls, and we can't use those. And so the question is, how do we create that mapping from CPU to read-write mutex? We can kind of hack it. And we can drop down into the assembly and call, at least on AMD 64 architectures, we can call the CPU ID instruction. And so that gives us the APIC ID of the processor that we're running on, which is basically a unique ID of the processor that we're on. And then on Linux, at least, we can read from proc CPU info. That gives us a list of all of the processors that are available to us. And then from there, we can create that mapping from processor to mutex. So this is called a big reader lock, by the way, this kind of distributed read-write mutex. And as you can see, it scales a lot better in comparison to the read-write mutex from the sync package. across, so looking at from like one all the way to 64 cores for really, you know, read heavy workloads, it scales a lot better. And so what this looks like in memory is we have this contiguous array of mutexes, one per processor. And we know each of these is 24 bytes wide. And on a modern processor, the cache line size is 64 bytes wide. And so we still run into that false sharing issue we saw before because two of these fit in a single cache line. And so we fix that the same way we fixed it before, which is we add that padding, the cache line padding, to prevent that false sharing problem. That basically pushes them into their own cache lines. We avoid that cache contention. And again, that has a pretty material impact on how this thing scales in comparison to without that padding. So I haven't had a chance to play around much with the new concurrent map that came in Go 1.9 recently. But I did notice they're using empty interface throughout the API, so that's still happening, I guess. Generics. So as kind of an unrelated side note, you know, I find it interesting. Go positions itself as a highly concurrent language, but at least in my opinion, it really doesn't bring a lot to the table as far as actually making it easy to build highly concurrent systems. So I think there's still a lot of work to be done as far as providing better primitives, better abstractions for actually building these things. Conclusions. The standard library provides general solutions, and they're generally what you should use. And seemingly small idiomatic decisions can have really profound impacts on performance. And the Go toolchain has a lot of tools for analyzing your code. It's well worth your time to learn those and to use those. And the Go compiler and runtime continue to improve. And the corollary to this is the performance profile of your code can change dramatically between releases. And so you should always go back and verify optimizations that you've made to make sure they're still valid. Relying on assumptions can be fatal. Read the Go language spec. Read the Go 1 compatibility agreement. And really, code is marginal, I think, in terms of performance. And what I mean by that is really the big wins come from architecture. And so it's important to get your architecture right first, and then you can start to look at more of the code level micro optimizations, because I think that's where your return on investment tends to be a lot smaller. But at the same time, peeking behind the curtains can pay dividends. And it's this idea of mechanical sympathy. And I think every engineer owes it to themselves to at least have a working understanding of like how the abstractions they use actually work. And above all, optimize for the right trade-off. You know, optimizing for performance usually means trading something else off in return for that, like code maintainability, for example. And there is no one right answer as far as when that trade-off makes sense. It all depends. And that's it. Thank you.